Hello, hello, everybody. It is 4 p.m. Central Time on the 7th of June, 2017. Welcome into the new Earthquake 3D live stream update time. Hope you guys are doing good. It looks like we're starting out with just about 200 people in the combined rooms between YouTube and Twitch, and that's, I guess, going to be expected until people catch wind that we're doing things during the day. Now, in case you miss it during the day, I'm going to replay the update at 10 p.m. And if anything happens in between, of course, I'll jump on and do an update as well. So, guys, welcome into, again, the early version of this. So let's talk about what hit since my update last night. And then going forward after today, we'll talk about what happened over the full 24-hour periods between my 4 p.m. updates. But in case you missed it, starting last night, the West Pacific lit up with activity. The North Pacific lit up with activity. The Mideast lit up. And out here on the Mid-Atlantic going up to the North Pole. And I mean, it's a dramatic increase. Also, volcanic eruption-wise, just let me quickly show you before we even get into the update. Look, so far today, I'm going to start here at the top of the list and just kind of scroll down. Look at everything since last night at 10 p.m. right here. So it's a big introduction of new eruptions and earthquake activity next to each set of volcanoes has also occurred. So right here in the middle, we'll start with the, kind of the larger of the earthquakes. Today, the number was 5.1 to 5.3 across the whole planet. Specifically, right here in the middle point where we were watching next to our Triangular Bend and Pagana and Langila volcanoes. 5.0 activity struck there. Additionally, up here to the north, in the middle of our silent zone, to the south middle point, down in the Philippines, activity going down into Indonesia, just east of Krakatoa. That's all in the past several hours. Down here in New Zealand, take a look at this, guys. 4.0 activity returning to the central part of the island. We talked about this last night. We said the process was going to repeat itself. Central was going to be hit by 4. Then we'll see activity to the north, and then again to the south. That's all about to take place over the next couple days, or less, maybe even the next 24 hours, north and then south will begin to start moving. So there's the 4, that's based upon the previous activity, in case you guys missed it over the past couple days. Also, up here in Alaska at the Aleutian Island chain, to the east of yesterday's 5.1, a new 5.1 to 5.3 struck at the Aleutians, right here next to Mount Atka, or Atka Island, which is a large volcano. So 5.3 there after yesterday's 5. I think that's pretty obvious. Pressure spreading from Kamchatka over to the east. Like I said, today's 5s are a sign. And I said we were going to get picking up in activity. We're going to see a huge increase. Well, look what happened out here on the Mid-Atlantic. South of Iceland, north of the Azores, here 5.1 as well. 5.1 starting to sound like a familiar number. How about up at the North Pole, 5.0 activity? Now, they downgraded it to 4.9, 4.6, but look where it struck, guys. Right on the letter X, which you can barely see here because of the way it's shaped, but right on the letter X, we have obviously a 5.0 earthquake next to Mount Dutch supervolcano and the Gackle Ridge. Where did that come from? Well, it came from the previous earthquakes all the way down here. I told you, this all adds together to about a 5.1. Well, that was over this past week. It transferred all the way up to the North Pole. Also went across Europe, in case you missed that. We'll talk about that in a second. But first things first, let's talk about the United States. Let's talk about what's going on here. Southern California hit by mid-range 3 activity, 3.4 and 3.3, added together to 3.5 as it originally was. Where did it strike? Well, the reason Southern California was hit is because of the 3.7 the day before up at the border. So Southern California was hit by a 3.5 or 3.6, not just anywhere, but near the San Andreas Fault, south of Los Angeles. So if you take a look at where it is, it's a Big Bear that's just north of the new magma chamber rising location, and a subsequent 3 struck right next to it to let you know all of Southern California has been inundated with pressure. Additionally, over to the east, check it out, guys, 3.4, similar-sized earthquake, right, to what just struck over in Southern California, 3.4 striking back in Oklahoma at the fracking operations, and up here in the northeast, Maine hit. And I got 2 letters from viewers in Maine over the past couple weeks. Well, I told them, just like I tell you guys almost every night, Maine does get hit. The Northeast does get hit by activity. Take a look at what hit over the past couple days, and I think it completes the picture for you now. From the West Coast to the Midwest to the East Coast, not just anywhere. Take a look at it right along the edge of the craton. All similar sized earthquakes, losing a little momentum as it goes across the plate. So professionals said there was no pressure transfer that occurred across the plates at all. That a 3 on the West Coast can't cause a 3 in the Midwest? Well, I think we proved that wrong. And also that 3s in the Midwest can cause 3s on the East Coast. 2s in the Midwest can cause 2s on the East Coast. That's why you need to pay attention to what's going on here on the West Coast, even if you're on the East Coast. Speaking of what's going on the West Coast, we have to go consult the slow slip tremor map for today for the last 24 hours. And specifically, let's look at the last 12. And in the last 12 hours, look what's starting to happen, guys. Coming out of California, transferring to central portion into Oregon. Since my update last night, the preponderance of earthquakes is striking pretty much in Oregon with just a few on either side. This fully confirms to me that the pattern that I was talking about the other night, that the slow slip is following, is going from north down to the south in California, then going central in Oregon, then back to the north, and then back to the south, central, north, south, central, north. But it started up to the north, so I really think the pattern is going north, south, central, north, south, central. But right now as it's moving, it's going from south to north. That's expected. And we're going to keep expecting this every day until a big earthquake hits. To fulfill the slow slip that's been going on across 700 miles or 650 miles of this area, it's been thousands of small tremors moving on land, accompanied at the same time. Same time there's thousands of small tremors happening here on land, there's just a single larger earthquake that accompanies that when it starts to transfer. So I'm looking at this point, now that it's transferring out of California, going up to Oregon, we have to look off the coast. And we've already been talking about this. I said today is day 7 of the watch for the 5.0 earthquake to strike in California. So on top of that, the slow slip is going to be striking with a large earthquake eventually once the slow slip stops. Where's the large earthquake most likely going to strike? Well, if the area on land is experiencing thousands of small tremors as the plates slide by one another, or next to one another, I should say, then the area and the areas off to the west out to sea are snapping with single larger earthquakes to compensate for that, then what's going to happen with the whole area? Obviously, there's going to be a single larger compensation earthquake that'll strike, most likely, right in the middle of the zone that's slipping. So the fulcrum point of the zone that's slipping is its own area we're watching. We're also watching off the coast of California for 5.0 activity based upon all the other fives striking around the plate over the past week. Just take a look at it. So pretty much everywhere else has been hit. There's only a few open spots. If there aren't volcanoes there, then we're looking for an earthquake to strike. Only along the red arrows around the Pacific at this point. Okay? So you got two things to worry about, unfortunately. One is a 5, not that big of a deal off the coast, again, from California into Oregon. Secondly, the one that I consider that is a big deal is the earthquake, the 7.7 or greater, that should strike here. Now, there is something I would like to bring up that we were talking about in chat earlier that's pretty phenomenal that I, you know, think you guys need to take into consideration. When the 7.7 struck here back in 2012 on October 27th in Vancouver Island, British Columbia, Canada, the same day that happened, Hurricane Sandy, Frankenstorm, was hitting the east coast of the United States. When that happened, when the hurricane was hitting the east coast of the U.S., before the earthquake struck up here in Canada, a spot down here in Mexico called La Canada, Mexico, experienced something that, well, I think we just need to take a look at. Let's see if this comes up this way. Oh, it sure does. Okay. On the 27th, this happened down in La Canada, Mexico. Let me just click on it so you can see it a little bit better. This is a radar station that lit up in a giant pulsing rotating vortex that went on for many hours. And that wasn't a storm or anything, guys. That was on a clear day down there. Now, same time, this sucker's pulsing. we have the hurricane up here off the east coast of the United States. That's Hurricane Frankenstorm, brought to life by lightning. And then you see, I got so many screenshots of it out of La Canada. And it just, I mean, look at it, guys. Look at that. So I just find it very strange that on the same day this happens out of La Canada, Mexico, there is then an earthquake up in Canada on the western coast of Canada. And this is a double torus shape being emanated from the radar itself. Okay. So, people made videos on this and so forth. I got screenshot after screenshot. You guys are welcome to go back and reference it if you want to. So when that was happening down here in Mexico the same day, then we got a 7.7 here off the coast as part of the slow slip up in Canada. Was it related? I think they were. I think the storm, Frankenstorm, the pulse down in La Canada, and the earthquake in Canada, all three were related since they all happened on the same day. So anyways, is that going to happen again? I don't know about the pulse, but I do know that the slow slip is going to be producing an earthquake greater than what happened back in 2012, because you can't get 650 to 700 miles across moving on land with thousands of tremors and not get some kind of final compensation movement out here in the middle of this whole mess, okay? So after that happens, well, we got two things to watch for. After the five hits, the one that we're expecting just based upon all the other five striking around the plate here off Northwest California, that will re-excite things back up down in Southern California, back down near the pumping operations to the volcano, which is just a small stretch between Santa Barbara and Salton Sea. So that's Southern California, as many people would know it, and we would watch there after the five hits here, and after the big one hits up here, after the large earthquake we're looking for to hit up here, we will immediately warn Southern California to be on watch for a huge increase, as well as Central California at the Nevada border. But first things first, you gotta wait for those earthquakes to strike. Right now, as it stands, we take a look at the smaller events, just quickly, guys, again, take a look at it here. So we look at all the smaller earthquakes, and when I say smaller, they're really stacked on top of each other. You're gonna notice something here at the center. See this? See this large stack of earthquakes? Obviously, we've got a swarm happening, not just anywhere, but happening back at that Volcanic Butte system that I showed you yesterday. This is, let's just go show it to you, actually. Picture speaks a thousand words. I don't just have to describe it. Now, to do this, let's go pull one of the larger earthquakes off this, a 2.4. Gardnerville, Ranchos, Nevada. Okay. All right, that's the location listed by the USGS. But what's actually there? Inquiring minds want to know. Click here to find out more. Okay, so you might zoom in on it. You say, oh, it looks like some trees and a little basin. Not much to look at, right? Wrong. Backing it out here, guys, we are just northwest of Aurora Crater and Aurora Peak. We are south of Steamboat Springs. I don't have any place marks downloaded for this location, which doesn't mean, I mean, look, there's probably some other volcanic and geyser-like features here. For instance, across west of Hawthorne, we know there's geyser fields, but they're not marked. So is there something at the location that I'm not aware of? China Springs, a sugar loaf, a bald mountain, Nevada Hill. Looks like we got a little town here. No pumping operations of any kind, and no observable volcanic activity nearby. But that doesn't mean much, because sometimes they're hidden. I always look within 40 miles. So, you know, we're further than 40 miles away. I know that, but let's just check. Let's see how far this is. Oh, look, exactly 40 miles. Look at that. Look at that. 39 to 40 miles away, we have this center of Steamboat Springs. I wonder how far it is to the south then. 50 miles down to Mud Springs, Volcanic Butte, and Aurora Crater. So if I were to lean towards one to be associated with, it would be with Steamboat Springs to the north. Since we always look within 40 miles, that's a predetermined number that I've come up with over the years. So it's not like anybody should be shocked by that. It's just ironic that it's a perfect match. Okay, well, it could be related to that. I would say, it's not volcanic. It's not going to actually cause an eruption or anything. It's a sandwich swarm between two volcanic locations, and it may very well be that there's an ancient volcano there. The other spots to the south, Mammoth Mountain Volcano and Volcano Peak, is now being hit down in the Coso Volcanic Field at Devil's Kitchen, and then Southern California lighting up at Salton Sea, going right along the San Andreas Fault. This is all San Andreas. Take a look at it. See how this is, see the shape of this? This should actually get your attention if you're paying attention to the smaller earthquakes or the earthquakes that are striking here. Let's just show you. See the greater red line there coming out of Salton Sea and going up to the west-northwest? Now compare to the earthquakes. See that? So the whole thing, how big is that? What do you think? 75, 100 miles, something like that? Going from east of LA all the way down to South Salton Sea. I want to know how much of a distance of the San Andreas is moving right now. Because that's pretty big, actually. So south of Salton Sea, like right here, and it goes up here to east of Los Angeles, out here. Yeah, 100 miles, 111 miles. You can take off 10 miles off that or add on 10 miles onto that. So about 100 miles distance right now is moved all day today. And it's all on the 0, 1, and 2 level. And, oh, I'm sorry, going up to 3. Going up to 3.2, not 2.2. So 3.2, 3.3 striking down there. Again, it's a sign. What is it a sign of? That all of California is being inundated with so much pressure that it's exciting these old volcanoes, and now we have a new compression point between volcanoes. It just means to me that it's a lot of movement. I told you yesterday, whenever Bittner Butte gets hit up to the north, we only have about a day to go before something strikes off the coast. There are other earthquakes striking up in Northern California that are worth considering. Up in North Sacramento Valley, look at this one, guys. Here, whoops, let me get the other reading on this from the USGS. Willows, California. Now, you think they would tell you about the volcano at the location and the pumping operation. You think they'd tell you about both if there's an earthquake striking there, right? Well, take a look at it. So here's our volcano just to the south. This is West Butte and South Butte Volcano in Northern Sacramento Valley. And then we get right up here, and we are right next to a large pumping operation. Now you say, pumping operation, those look like farm fields. Well, guys, mixed in with the farm fields, we have oil and gas operations. That's not for pumping out water. These are for oil and gas. And they, I guess the farmers have things worked out with them or whatever. But, yeah. So oil and gas out here in the valley, and then you get hit by an earthquake at the location. They're related. You can't ignore that. Okay, so you need to be paying attention to those. Deep 5.0 just struck, guys. Deep 5.0 earthquake just struck right on our letter D. Look at that. Look at this. Let's get our international feed turned back on here. Wow. Okay, a new deep 5.0 earthquake at 543 kilometers down. Okay, we gotta look at this. This is a perfect time to explain everything to new people who are here. Take a look at the screen now. We're looking through Earth. We're still looking down on the 5.0 earthquake. This little green island down to the south is New Zealand, okay? So you're looking through. It might look a little confusing, but really quick, let me turn on something called the shell. The shell is going to show us a sphere surrounding the earthquake. So now you kind of get a three-dimensional picture of the Earth. And I'm going to turn off a view so it doesn't look so confusing. Now you can see Australia. You can see New Zealand here, the Green Island. Okay, and the earthquake is up to the north. So I want you to imagine this sphere as a sphere of pressure coming up from down below the plate. And as the pressure comes up from down below, it pushes out on all sides at once. And a deep 5.0 earthquake is big enough, enough power is coming up off this, like a jackhammering pressure coming up on the underside of the plate, that it's enough to displace things in all directions, west, south, and east, since there are fracture points west, south, and east from this location. Let me show those to you now. So here we go. Take a look at it. There we go. There's the deep 5.0 earthquake. Now take a look in all directions from here. We have arrows. The arrows are along the fracture zone. So we added the arrows to show which way pressure flows from these spots. This has happened so many times in the past. When a deep 5 happens here, usually it's a big enough earthquake to push all the way across over to South America and hit South America like a car hitting a wall. And with the pressure hitting the wall, it tries to go around the plate and underneath the plate, since it can't go over the plate. And where the two big arrows point, there's going to be a dramatic re-excitement with larger earthquake activity in the next 48 to 72 hours. Additionally, to the west of this deep earthquake, there's going to be a shallower, larger earthquake than the 5.0. It could go 5.0 up two notches. So if it goes up one notch, it goes up to 6.0. If it goes up two notches, which is pretty unlikely, but it does happen from time to time, we have to warn for it. It happens enough. So it could go 6.0 to 7.0 to the west. To the south, this is the only good news I've got for you down in New Zealand. To the south, fives up here usually cause upper fours or near fives to strike at your plate boundary. It also causes swarms to strike on the North Island at your volcanoes. It causes 5.0 and greater earthquakes to strike at your catcher's mitt position on the North Island. And ultimately, it causes large earthquakes to strike the south part of the island going down to that letter X. And I say large like what happened just this past week. It goes fives, mid-range fives. I haven't seen it six in a long time, so six is kind of rare. But, you know, it goes up down here to the south. All the pressure builds back up and kind of pools up here and finally strikes with one larger earthquake after we see earthquakes strike up to the north. So a new deep five up to your north means we're going to see a dramatic increase in New Zealand in the next 72 hours. The good news is that it's not going to go into a megaquake or anything like that. The highest I see it going would be equal to what's happening down up here, because most of the pressure on this big guy is going to go to the east and to the west. Now, speaking of going to the west, where is the 6 to 7.0 earthquake going to strike? Most likely, the 6 to 7.0 earthquake is going to strike between our two earthquakes that have currently happened. So you see a 5.0 to the west and a deep 5.0 here raised high off the globe. Look in between these spots and we'll look for at least a one magnitude larger earthquake somewhere in the upper 5 to 6.0 range to strike here. It could go larger, guys, but it's a halfway point. Now let me turn off the shells so we don't get so confusing here in the way we're looking at it. Again, take a look at it. 5.0 earthquake here, I'll highlight it in blue, and then the most recent earthquake in green. Halfway point between those two earthquakes, go around the bend, brings us here into Tonga. Okay? But it's not going to stop there. No. Look, we're in the middle of a deep earthquake event. Look at the last several days worth of deep earthquakes, guys. I told you, we were looking for an equinoxial deep earthquake event to happen. This happened back in December. It started with 1, then it went to 3, then it went to 5. Now we're looking at the kind of the same thing happening here. We have so many deep earthquakes over the past several days, and I called it a couple days ago, calling it a deep earthquake event. And I think it's associated with the tilt of the planet, and it explains why back in December the same thing happened. Now you'll remember the result of that was 25 deep earthquakes, or more, maybe even 29. There was some debate on a few of them, and several of them didn't get reported. But 20-something deep earthquakes, followed by three different 7.9s. Two 7.9s over here in the West Pacific in between the deep earthquakes back in December, 6 months ago, guys. And then on Christmas Day, one 7.9 here in Chile on Christmas Day. So that's three 7.9s in the month of December. Haven't seen anything like it since. And here we are. We're 6 months later, and we're going into the final tilt towards the north. And what starts to happen? A bunch of deep earthquakes that then start to move and cause shallower, larger earthquakes and a huge increase in volcanic eruptions. That's the other thing. Take a look at it right here in the center. See, we're missing some earthquakes right in here. What we're not missing, let me just show you what we're not missing. Langila volcano, Bagana volcano. So Langila and Bagana and Manam, all three erupting today. And where are they? Take a look at it. They're right here. Manam is right here. Langila and Bagana are here in eastern Papua New Guinea, and there's no earthquakes. Well, that's going to change. With a new deep five, we also have to be warning this location right in the middle. But we have to warn them for more like an upper 5 to be striking. Maybe a little bit larger. Don't fault me if it goes above upper 5. But the 3 volcanoes erupting have been relieving some of that pressure and just biding the time. Now we have a new push. This new push is definitely enough to push the whole plate. 1 deep 5 is enough to push the whole plate, guys. We've seen it in the past. It's going to happen again. I'm glad it happened here on the stream so that you can see it real time. We can warn the several areas. If you live up in Japan, guess what? This sucker down here plays into you. It does. A deep 5 here at Fiji usually causes movement to spread all the way up past Japan, hitting Japan, and terminating somewhere up here or even going around and fizzling out across the Aleutian Island chain going into Canada. But look, it's going to happen in the next 48 hours, 72 hours at the most. We're going to see this spread out to the west. Taking into account the volcanic eruptions, we need to see if Sakurajima is on the list for today. So let's just go down the list. Is Sakurajima on the list? Oh, I see a new addition. Sangang Appy. That's a new one. But let's go see if Sakurajima's on here. I don't see it. Oh, another one. A new, again, guys, Semeru. Another new addition to the list. Look at that. All right. So Sakurajima is not on the list. This means Japan is primed and ready to go. It's most likely going to be struck to the south, then the central, then the north. So it's going to go south, central, north. It might happen within the next 72 hours or less. Now that the volcano stopped, I told you, once the volcano stops, it's like cashing in your rain check. You got to come in and pay the bill. Okay, it's all coming in due at once. And unless it blows today, if it blows today, it might buy you another day's time. So we have to add up what's striking volcano-wise and earthquake-wise to come to the determination of what's going to be striking in Japan and where. So south of Japan, the forecast from last night holds true. We're watching down to the south at Okinawa. The other spots were hit, okay? So we already know what to watch for there. But going forward, now I'm watching because of the deep 5 and the other 5s progressing around and the volcanic eruption stopping. We're going to put it up at about a 5.9 to 6.0. 5.9 to 6.0. And this is going to come after Okinawa. So 5.9 to 6.0, we'll put it up to 72 hours from now. There may even be, since there's one deep earthquake here, we might see a rash of new deep earthquakes because this might not be the only one we've seen. In the next few hours, there's probably going to be a few more. Usually this is enough to displace things as well and cause other deep earthquakes at our letter Ds going all the way over towards Asia. So this is big time go time. Have a plan and be prepared about this, guys, because we're in the middle of a deep earthquake event. We're at the tilt, the extreme tilt, and there's other stuff going on solar-wise that I wouldn't even, you know, normally talk about, but that's also happening. Now we need to talk about a few other locations. Now that you understand what to look for down in New Zealand. Oh, look, guys, whoop, hold on. Is this right? Yep, new deep 4.3 to the north. Is that right? Sure is. Where did this sucker come from? Did that just pop on the feed? Did I miss that? How could I miss that? A new deep 4.3, 176 kilometers here at the Kermadec Islands, North New Zealand. How did we miss that? It would have been on there. I just looked it up. I just had the feed open. All right, well, guys, check it out. A new deep 4.3 has been reported here at the north part of New Zealand. So we just told you, a 4 here would lead to a larger earthquake up here to the north, up to 5. Well, let's get it. Yeah, GeoNet. Yeah, it's coming in from GeoNet. Sure is. All right, well, I think that's pretty obvious. Okay, so what do we have going on there? We obviously have pressure transferring to the north, the new deep earthquake as well. Oh, man. Look, it looks like a stair step coming up from very far down below, raised up high, then halfway, then the surface. Yeah, there we go. What else do we have going on? Oh, yeah, getting over towards Europe. Guys, with the activity that's hit over the last day and a half over here at Iran, a new 5.0 earthquake now downgraded to 4.6, striking in South Ukraine. But this is right at the Iran border. Take a look at it. Here, let me turn the rings down. So the bigger earthquake here, right at the Iran border. And it's right where the two arrows come together. Well, you may remember, or you might not. Two nights ago, one of my viewers came in and made the report, because the USGS and EMSC didn't give it to us. A 5.9 earthquake struck in Xinjiang, China, here in central China along the Chinese Craton edge. And I told you guys we would know for certain if it really did strike, because downstream from there, we would see a dramatic re-excitement in Iran going west into Turkey. Over the last day and a half, look at it. Here, let me get all the smaller earthquakes turned off so you can really see this, man, because this to me is proof positive. Look at both sides of the plate boundary here where both arrows are. Similar sized earthquakes striking on both sides. This follows that 5.9. So the 5.9 pushed to the west, and now it's re-excited things across Iran going into Turkey. What does that mean for the area in western Turkey? What does it mean for the people in Greece? What does it mean for the people in Italy? Well, unfortunately, it means a new excitement is coming your way on a 5.0 level. Now, they downgraded this 4.6, but if you take the 4.6 and add in a 4.2 and another 4.2, we get to 4.8 to 4.9. Add in all the other 2s and 3s, and we're at a 5.0 level. Where is it going to strike? I've told you this before, I'll tell you again. If the earthquakes, it's going to strike South Europe at the Turkey-Greece border region. But if it strikes south of Crete, right here, then pressure will transfer up into Italy. If it strikes north of Crete, right here, the pressure is going to go to the north, up across Romania, up across Bosnia, and so forth, like we talked about Montenegro, and we talked about Poland, and we talked about all the way up at the English Channel. Those were all hit this past week. You got to remember, again, they were all hit, as expected, this past week. So it's going to happen again. A new 5.0 type earthquake is coming in right now. It'll be here within the next day and a half to 2 days, 48 hours, European time. So we're already in Europe. It's, I think, the 8th, or getting to be the 8th the most. So, 2 days. So by Saturday at the most, you should be seeing a new 5.0 type earthquake striking across Crete into Turkey. Again, if it strikes just south of Crete, then I'll be warning the people in central Italy for a new swarm and possibly topping out in the 4.0 range earthquake, which is enough to shake things up. It all took place this last week as expected. The earthquake struck back here in Turkey. It directed the flow of pressure up to the north across Romania, across Poland, and across the English Channel, even striking in Scotland, then striking out here on the north mid-Atlantic ridge with these earthquakes, of course, that you see here on the screen. Now, so that all took place this past week. Additionally, the pressure was directed down to the south across Algeria, going out through Portugal, and going out to the mid-Atlantic ridge this way. So Italy, you've had somebody standing in your way for the last several weeks, if not a couple months. Who's standing in your way? Who's standing in the way of your pressure? Greece. Greece at the Ionia range. It's blocking the flow back behind it. I don't know how long it's going to continue to block the flow. It gave forth last year in August. Last year in August is when the Ionia range got hit with the upper five and a huge swarm of a couple hundred to a few thousand earthquakes, or several hundred to a few thousand earthquakes struck there. And then the whole mountain range moved about 50 miles across and 20 miles wide, or 50 miles long, 20 miles wide, got pushed to the west by several inches, many centimeters. And then within, a week? Not even. 5 days after that, boom, central Italy was hit. So what I'm worried about is that it could happen again. What? What? 5.1 in Poland? What? 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 You gotta be kidding me, man. What? Hold on. Wow, this is turning into a kind of an exciting update today. What's going on? Let me get a sip of my coffee. Oh, yeah, yep. Look at that. Look at that. How many stations do we have? 10 stations. 10 stations reporting. 10 stations reporting. 5.3, 4.6, 5.0, 5.4, 5.2, 3.5 you can throw out. I would throw out the ultra high and ultra low, but 10 stations reporting means something hit. 10 stations can't be wrong. 10 stations can't be wrong. What's this earthquake up here? What's this one? Germany? What? Well, you know what? I'm not going to pass it up. A 5.1 striking in Poland, it might be larger, it might be smaller, it could be a 4.1. It would be consistent with the other fours that are striking here. If it was just one or two stations, I would say, Montenegro, problem or something. But they're giving us all the data on it. That's 10 stations reporting it. It would make sense. It would make sense because, like I just said, there was a 4.9 to 5.0 energy coming in here to Turkey. I mean, if it struck up to the north, it would mean that, it would mean the 5.9 over here, actually, it would mean the 5.9 over here that they didn't report traveled across the Caspian Sea and Black Sea and then kind of crashed down to a 5.1 here into the edge of the craton. And if it were, let me just take a guess. The earthquake that's being reported is going to be showing up right here in Poland. What are the chances? Let's go see. Poland, let's get our coordinates. I don't know. I'm just guessing. If I'm right, then the chances are it's a real earthquake. If I'm wrong and it goes somewhere else, then it might just be an erroneous, maybe they're detonating bombs or something there. Who knows? Where does it take us? Into an urban area. Okay, well, that rules out bombs. Where is this? Man, it's close. Oh, it's close to the, it's in the same rough county region. I guess these are counties there. One county to the north of the last 4.0 to hit there. Interesting. Anything else there that we need to see? I know they do fracking in some of these places, but I don't see any fracking operations of any kind. Oh wow. This would be fun to go do a street level on. Okay. All right. So now you understand, guys, this is why we do what we do. We have to check everything. I can tell you this. They didn't report the 5.9 out here in China, and it did strike. Because the after effects of it, the pressure transfer into the West, did these just pop up out of nowhere? I mean, no, they came from the pressure transferring out of China, which means the USGS didn't show us 5.9 activity, which then I wouldn't put it past them to not show us 5.1 activity when it conflicts with anything that they've said. 5.1 would be the number of the day. Like I said, 5s and 5.1s have struck all around the plate today, so I think that would hold consistent as well. If it really did hit. Other locations we need to talk about. Central America and South America. No bueno, guys. No bueno. Take a look at the volcanic ash advisory feed for today. So just starting back at the top of the list, we'll go down the list. Sabancaya and Poes and Reventador. And Sabancaya, Poes, Reventador. No, we got more on there. Poes, Reventador. Oh, yeah. Sabancaya again. Reventador again. This is all today. So let's show you where these are. So it's multiple eruptions and reports. Again, Poes is right here in Central America, where the letter V is. Reventador is right here in Ecuador, where the letter V is. And Sabancaya is right here, where the letter V is. So it's a dramatic excitement going across equidistantly spaced, if you were to stretch this out. I know it's kind of bent up right now, but if you were to stretch this out, you'd see that each volcano is equidistantly spaced and all three are being hit by eruptions. Each volcano is going to be accompanied by 5.0 or greater earthquakes next to each volcano. So that means Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Panama area, going as far north as El Salvador needs to be warned, and down to the south at the Colombia-Ecuador border region right here. And then going further to the south in Peru needs to be warned right here in North Peru. Why do we need to warn them? Because, again, the areas are sandwiched in between the volcanoes. And over the last day and a half, do you notice anything? Last day and a half. Normally, this location from Central America to South America is littered with earthquake activity. Now that we have a new Deep 5 pushing in from over here, look where both arrows point. Where both arrows point, dramatic re-excitement coming in the next day and a half. Could be one magnitude larger than the 5, could be 2. I'm leaning towards 1. As high as 1 magnitude higher than this Deep 5 over here could cause at least a upper 5, maybe even a 6 at both locations. Both. We're already looking for 5.0, mid-range 5.0 activity, 5.3 to something, striking up here in Colombia. And down to the south, the eruptions already happened at Nevados del Chalán. So it's going to be a big weekend. It's going to be huge. This weekend's going to be a big deal. So we need to have a plan and be prepared. If you're on the coast of the United States, understand that, again, we're talking about the rest of the world right now. But when you see the rest of the planet popping off with fives, and you see a deep earthquake like this, and then I turn it down for the last several days, and I show you all the other deep earthquakes raised high off the globe, you know half the Pacific has moved down below. It means the other half is going to move shallow. It's going to compensate. So if you're pushing up on the underside of one portion of the plate, the other side of the plate is going to compensate. It is. It happens on a daily and weekly basis that way. If you live up in Japan, I want you to be prepared for two things. Now that Sakurajima has stopped, now that we're watching two different spots in Japan, both are going to be hit. It's not a 50-50 flip, guys. This is 100%. Both spots are going to be hit down near Okinawa and up here on the coast of Honshu, or very close to it. And both are going to be hit, like I said, due to the activity coming up from the south. One final thing for my Aussie viewers. Good day. That's not a knife. That's not a knife. That's a knife. Oh, okay, anyways, check it out. 3.1 striking right here at the central north part of the Australian Craton, due north of Uluru and Ayers Rock. And it's pretty far north. I mean, don't get me wrong. It's several hundred miles to the north. But let me just show you. Let's get our coordinates. Here we go. Now, we talked about this, how the central part of Australia is pushed up on the underside like a circus top. And a circus tent. And then the sides move. So we talked about how yesterday the swarms were the result of the previous deep earthquakes. Now today, a new 3.1 striking here. And again, just look at it. Just look at it. So Northern Territory, obviously we're going across a huge mountain range called the McDonnell Ranges. The McDonnell Ranges on both sides. You have Uluru on one side to the southwest. Right here, Uluru. Ayers Rock, dang it. Okay, right here, and then up here across the range, almost the same space on the other side of the range, like the same mileage to the range, we have the earthquake, which is at kind of a small rising location, very low, poor imagery provided here. Okay, so just understand, pressure comes up on the underside of Australia, and when it does, it seeks the path of least resistance, causing earthquakes at the center, and then spreading out on all the other sides. Olaru. Olaru? Are you serious? Hold on. Olaru. Olaru. Oh, you Aussies. Do me a favor and please say Missouri. But wait, it's not Missouri. It's Missouri. Dang it. Okay. New Madrid. Potato, potato. Tomato, tomato. All right, guys. I love doing this. This is why I do what I do. Also, I would like to tell you guys one more thing. With what's happening right now, it would be prudent for you to pay attention to where these things are striking. I mean, you can wait for me to come on and do the updates. But I would encourage you to, again, that's why I've got the stream running. So the stream's on so you can check in throughout the day to see where they're striking compared to where I'm telling you they're going to strike. I can tell you this. The silent zones are going to be hit very soon here. The silent zones are the spots where you don't see any earthquakes and we don't have any eruptions. So if there's no eruptions and there's no earthquakes at the spot and there's a red line that goes across it, it's a spot that should be hit very soon, at least around the Pacific. And we don't just look anywhere along the red line. you look at the central point of the silent zone. I call it the fulcrum point, the spot where all the pressure builds up at the center, whether it's between two earthquakes or two volcanoes or five earthquakes and five volcanoes. The fulcrum point tends to be hit with the combined total of everything around it. Isn't that amazing that it's that simple? That the earthquakes or seismic pressure on both sides or three sides or four sides of an area, you look to the middle of the silent zone in between all of that, and it gets hit next with the combined total of everything around it. And the way you add them up is simple, by simple Richter addition. So it takes 10 twos to equal a 3, 10 threes to equal a 4, 10 fours to equal a 5, 10 fives to equal a 6, 10 sixes to equal a 7, 10 sevens to equal a 8, and so forth. 10 eights to equal a 9. And so you add them up on both sides, and it gives you what strikes in the middle. That can be a good, handy thing that you can do yourself and watch as the earthquakes come your direction, wherever you are. So if you're on the west coast of the United States, you know you're slow slipping. You know you're due for a 5.0 earthquake and something above 7.7, and you know it's not going to be months and years. It's going to be weeks into months at the most for that to happen. That's when you need the plan. And I've told you the spot to watch. The fulcrum point. The spot where it just so happens to look like it's happened 1,000 other times in the past. Take a look at this really quick, guys, and then we'll end this broadcast for tonight. For this afternoon. The fracture zone here off the west coast, the Juan de Fuca, as I zoom in on it, you'll see it's a triangular bend, but look at all the different ridges here. All these ridges, I believe, are like tree rings almost. Every time there's been a huge pressure buildup, it's caused a buckling in the plate that then pushes up or down, depending on which way the buckle happens, and that causes a tsunami to form out here in both directions, heading out in again towards land. But it's a different type of zone than the professionals are worried about, which is the subduction zone, they call it, here off the coast by 50 miles. But I'm talking a couple hundred miles off the coast. We have our main fracture zone that appears to have fractured so many times in the past and formed all these ridges. So every time it builds up, too much pressure builds up, where is it building up from? Well, I think we're kind of given a sign of where it's coming from, where the pressure is coming from, by the direction that the fracture zone's pointing and the direction that the buildup is occurring from northwest to southeast. It's pretty obvious. All the fracture zones, all the buildup, all the ridges go northeast to southwest or southwest to northeast, even going down the ridge this way and then connecting back this way. What does that mean? It means pressures always come in from the northwest, come in from up here to the northwest, pushing down in on this area. Then it pushes the United States all the way to the east, and it causes earthquakes like what we're seeing today. Over the last 24 hours here in the United States, you can see it spelled out before your eyes, pushing heavier movement on the west coast, moderate movement in the Midwest, lighter movement on the east coast. So what's pushing it all? Something here. Now that you know that, and you know that it's happening right now, you can make appropriate plans to plan for that, and plan for something greater than what happened in 2012. Time frame on this, until the slow slip stops, I'm not going to shut up about it. Once the slow slip stops, as soon as it really starts to die out, we'll be looking for a large earthquake, and then if it doesn't hit within a few weeks' time, we will fully cancel the warning and never talk about it again until it happens again. But the chances of nothing happening? The chances of nothing happening are about the chances of you winning the lottery, okay? Something's going to happen out of this that's larger than any of the events that hit so far. You can't get 650 miles worth of movement and 12 to 13 weeks of activity and not see some kind of compensation that's great enough to equal all of that. Let me just put it that way. Energy doesn't just disappear. All right, so that's what I've got for you. I want to thank everybody for tuning in today. It looks like we're topping out at about 400 people, and that's really cool to see. In the afternoon, please get the word out to everybody. I'm doing updates in the afternoon, and we're going to be replaying this tonight at 10 p.m. If anything else hits in between, I will, of course, jump on and do updates. So, guys, I hope you, again, are prepared. I hope you take the warning serious, but don't freak out too hard. This is why we do what we do. There is no randomness to earthquakes. There is no randomness. They happen in specific locations for specific reasons. For instance, this new deep earthquake here, there's a reason it struck, most likely because of the Earth-facing coronal stream, fast solar wind that people are talking about. So again, you know, I don't normally do solar, but I can just tell you when the solar events pick up, our deep earthquakes pick up. And there's an electric reason for that. There's a reason that the power goes to ground, goes down to the core of the Earth, re-excites things in the core, pushes up from pressure, causes deep earthquakes down below the plate, and that excites things for the whole planet. So I hope you understand that's what the, you know, the solar aspect on that ties into the whole planet, and it increases. So strong solar wind equals strong earthquake week. Okay? Tonight at 10 p.m., yes, it is still on, but it won't be like my normal 10 p.m. updates. It will be a replay of this specific update, and then an update further if any earthquake activity strikes between now and 10 p.m. This will be saved on my YouTube channel for you to share with the rest of the planet so they can get the updates. If you live down in New Zealand, share with your fellow New Zealanders. Let them know you got a new deep five up to your north. It could increase things. You should see swarms and larger earthquake activity. If you know anybody who lives west of Fiji, over in Indonesia, over in Papua New Guinea, I've been told there's hundreds of thousands of people that live on those small islands, and they're all on the internet because they came over to tell me they live there when I said nobody lives on the islands. So let those people know they could go up a full 2 magnitudes, 1 to 2 from that 5. That 5 could cause a 6 to 7. Let the people in Japan know. They're due at 2 spots, down to the south at Okinawa and at central Japan. Not just for any small activity. I'm talking about going up into the upper 5 to 6.0 range. Going over to the west, if you're over in Turkey, in Greece, guys, you're going to go up to 5 very soon here. And then in Italy, you're going to go up to 4 if it hits south of Crete. If it hits north of Crete, then we're going to go up to 4 up in Romania and up in Poland. I mean, this is a big deal for this week. It is go time, man. And it's summertime. So, you know, there's no excuse. People are off work a lot of times. A lot of kids are off school and so forth. You can get the warnings out easily. You could even just write down what I'm talking about here, guys. You could write it down and call the people or send them an email and say, hey, I just heard you're sandwiched in between two volcanoes and they're moving. So just be on watch. Much love. Talk to you later. Have a good one. I mean, that kind of warning could save a life. And it wouldn't even, like, you're not telling them to go buy stockpiles of food and water. You're just saying, hey, I heard you're sandwiched between two sets of earthquakes in case you didn't know. And they don't know. They're like, what? Oh, we're sandwiched between two sets of earthquakes? Well, shouldn't we get a warning? And then you'll say, well, the professionals don't want to warn you because they're too worried about saving their reputation in case they're wrong. Yeah, they're too worried. They're more worried about their reputations and being wrong than coming in and telling you guys that you're sandwiched between two sets of obvious activity. Isn't that asinine? Yeah, that's what I'm here for. That's what I'm here for. Okay. Much love, guys. Serious much love. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll